I'm a learner for real, like not just schoolwork. Like I just pay attention to everything. So I'm in Dubai and we did the podcast, but I didn't bring my computer with me because I promised my wife that it wasn't gonna be that kind of trip, right? So I'm like, if I bring my computer though, she gonna think it's gonna be that kind of trip, right? And we're gonna end up getting into it, right? So my wife was like, we're going to Dubai, we're going 2 weeks, you ain't doing no work. I'm like, bet, I got you, no computer. So I brought my little recorder though to do the podcast, and it's got like a SIM card like in it. And then you gotta take that card, put that in the computer, and then you send it, right? So I was like, some kind of way, this Dubai, I heard about Dubai, it's supposed to be all that in the bag of chips. They gotta have an Apple store. So I put my joint in there, right? And what was the problem? Like it fit, everything worked, but what was the problem with the store I was in? Okay, yep, but a connection, but what kind? No, it was a connection, internet connection, but it was what? It was weak. So I was sitting there for like 40 minutes. It was like 3%. I'm like, this ain't gonna work. My girl like, I thought we wasn't gonna, you gonna want me, you doing no work. You were here for 40 minutes. I'm like, oh, this is, okay, I'm out. You know what I'm saying? I'm like, abandon ship, abort that boy. So I go to the concierge like, bro, I need to, and I listen to me, this is why I tell y'all for real, like, you can't be average and think you're gonna make your dreams become a reality and you're gonna be paid and you're gonna live life happy. It don't work like that. So I go to the first girl, she tell me what? She said, nope, we don't know how. I'm like, all right. I go to the next young lady, she told me what? She can't do it. Now these were the two people, listen to me carefully. These were the two people who worked behind the desk. My man came out, my man was sitting on the side with a suit on. You thinking people just get jobs because they get jobs, right? That's what you thinking, right? But I went to the first person, she told me no. I went to the second girl, she told me no. My man with the suit on the back looking suave. My man said, what you need? I love it. Like, that's why my man getting paid more than they getting paid. Listen to me very closely. When you graduate and you get a job, if you want to get paid, you never say no. You never say it can't get done. Don't you ever say out your mouth it can't get done. Even if you feel in your heart it can't get done, you don't say it out loud. You let the broke folks say that. You let the folks they firing first say that. You always say it can get done. Even if you don't think it can get done, just say it and try to make up something. I'm being real. Let me tell y'all something. When y'all graduate and y'all start working for folks, and they can tell you just there to get paid, you're gonna be out of there quick. You don't take no ownership, you're gonna be out there quick. You're gonna be gone. My man walked out like, yo, what you need, bro? I was like, I got it, whatever. He's like, okay, we got a computer over there, we selling it, but, you know, so I don't know if you want your stuff on there, but if you don't mind your information being on the computer, it's all good, go for it. I'm like, bet. My man talking to me in English, and it's a sweet English, but I could tell that ain't his first language, though. He was from India. So he was rolling with me, but a couple of them I had to stop and hear what my man was saying. I was like, all right, boom, got it. So then I noticed that an older Indian man came in and he was flowing with homie. And then I noticed somebody that was from Dubai who spoke Arabic came in and my man was, boom, answering their question. I'm like, my man, that's three. I'm like, that's three right there. My man, just in a couple minutes, he did the English boy, got me what I wanted. He was talking to the older dude from India. An Arabic family came in. My man went boom, boom, boom. Then somebody Latino came in. My man started speaking Spanish. I was like, what is happening in front of me? Pulled my man to the side when it slowed down. I was like, homie, how many languages you speak? He said, I speak six. I said, what school you go to when you was little? He told me. I was like, so they just teach all them languages? He's like, no, they only taught us one language in India. We don't learn six. I was like, well, when you learn the other four or five? He was like, oh, when I moved to Dubai 4 years ago. I was like, you learn four or five languages in 4 years? He was like, yeah. I was like, how? He's like, it's the only way you eat. He's like, if you only speak one language, you outside with like the masses, like in 180 degree weather. It's the desert, it's hot. He like, you out there with them, and all they doing is building buildings. That's all they do. And you can see it, like when you leave a resort, you can see like buses and groves. And they on the buses and groves, and they shipping them to do construction work. My man in the five-star resort living live. I'm like, how do they live here? He's like, well, don't believe the hype. Everybody tell y'all how sweet it is, but most of them live in 6 to 7 to an apartment. But me and my roommate, we live together. I said, why? He said, we speak four languages, so we can work at the resort. Y'all hear what I'm telling you? Don't be average. So I want you to ask yourself, and we're going through this, the problem with privilege. I want you to ask yourself, do you have a spirit of entitlement? You got dreams and goals. but you entitled. The problem I have with most kids, if I tell you what it takes, most of you will die of exhaustion. You'd pass out before you reach 10,000 hours. You don't got the heart for it. You don't have the stamina for it. You couldn't take what it really takes. What makes y'all stop, or what makes y'all tired, or what makes y'all angry, or what makes y'all frustrated? I'm just thinking, if the slaves would have made it with this mentality that we have today. They was walking. Y'all talking about, man, we got it hard, while you on your Uber app. Just let me get that. Man, I'm having a rough day, bro, I promise you. They out here killing me. Yeah, I did. Boom, address, yeah, boom. All right, yeah, he'll be in 5 minutes. Let's keep complaining till my man get here. You Ubering, you ordering, like, you complaining, you ordering Chipotle for you before you get there. You didn't place your order, walking in like, I can't believe it's just, they killing me. That's me, let me get that. So all I'm saying is, like, I'm not against you. I'm here because I love you and I want to see you succeed and I believe you can. But how do you learn 4 or 5 languages in 4 years? Because you have to. I just want you to get to a point where you work so hard that you can't get played.
Good. So number one, listen to me. Don't write this down. It's not a principle. Listen quickly. I'll give you the first principle. Number one, this is not the principle. It's going to be a dogfight. I would love to tell you that on the road to success, everything is going to work out. It's not. It's going to be a dogfight. It's going to be a dogfight. For those of you watching my videos, on the road to success, I lost 5 aunts to cancer. It's a dogfight. In the midst of my business, I lost aunts. I had to go to funerals. We had to get on a plane. We had to drive. We had aunts that are close to my age who died, who didn't have insurance. We had to raise money. A dogfight. I had cousins shot in stores, execution style, shot back of the head twice. It's a dogfight. Like, you don't see that on YouTube. You don't see that on my TGIF. It's a dogfight. My wife, 3 years ago, 7 lesions found on her brain. It's a dog fight. It hadn't been easy. It's a dog fight. It hadn't been, the road hadn't been success. Like, it's just a paved road. And like, each he go this way. It's been rough. It's been crooked. It's been hard. But I've made up in my mind that I will get a reward for the pain that I go through. I will not stop in the middle of the process. I will not be defeated. I will not be destroyed. I will take everything that happens in my life and I will allow the pain to push me to greatness. You will not break me. You will not stop me. You will not defeat me. The only way I lose is if I quit. It's going to be a dogfight. And so if you're ready to quit, then don't get started. If you're ready to quit, don't get started. If you're looking for this easy path, don't get started. If you think they're not going to close the door on you and say no 1,000,000 times, don't get started. But every time they close the door, I just get excited. Why? Because I am not a no. I'm 1 yes away. I'm young. I'm 1 yes away. You can't keep telling me no forever. You can't keep denying me forever. This type of energy, this type of passion, you can't stop it. You can contain it for a while, but you cannot stop. This is life. And you can't defeat me. There is not. You don't have enough power. You don't have enough energy. You don't have enough strength to stop this. Contain it for a year, you might. 2 years, you might. You do not have hate, does not have enough energy to destroy love. You cannot destroy this. And so I'm telling you today, it's going to be a dog fight. And the sooner you realize it's going to be a dog fight. Okay, so let me just say this to you. So in America, right, and I'm sure it's the same thing here, but they're in our armed forces. Let's just pick one. The Navy, for instance. We just pick the Navy, right? Well, let me tell you guys, this is good. Listen to me very closely. The first thing they teach you, somebody over here, help me out. You are in the Navy, right? They're teaching you war. Right? What's the first thing they teach you? Boot camp. The very first. Somebody jump over here. Just take a wild guess. What's the first thing they teach soldiers?
Courage.
Good. Courage. Okay. This side. Discipline. So give me something practical. What's the first practical thing that they would teach you? Say it again. Defending yourself. Somebody over here. How to swim. Listen to me very closely. The first thing they teach you, the very first thing they teach you, is how to respond when you have a jam gun. And number two, how to carry your dead body. That's the first thing they teach you. They don't teach you how to defend yourself. They don't teach you how to swim. The first thing they teach you is when your gun is jammed. The first thing they teach you is a dead body, how to carry a dead body. And somebody tell me, why would they start you there? That's the worst case scenario. That's what you're not prepared for. That's what you're not thinking. You're not thinking when you go out there to defend yourself that your gun is going to jam. You're not thinking when you go out there that your boy going to get killed and you got to drag. You're not thinking that. So listen to me. It's not hardships that hurt us. It's not my cousin getting shot twice. It's not my cousin spending 50 years in jail. It's not my aunt dying of cancer. It's not my wife being diagnosed with seven lesions on her brain that will break you. What will break most people is you didn't prepare for that. So when you put all your little goals and all your little dreams together, it's not the thing that broke you that broke you. It was you never even thought about the fact that you could be broken. You never prepared. You never prepared for worst case scenario. And the reason why E.T. is standing here, because I prepared for it. If you know anything about me, I still lay on floors. I still eat chips off the floor. I still do some stuff that to most people is crazy. Like, E.T., why would you do that? Because I'm always prepared that we may not live in that house one day. One day something might happen and we might have to go back to that. And if I have to go back to that, it's not going to break me. And so I present to you a diamond. Most women love them. And most men spend a lot of money on them. I'm going to say it again. Most women love them. And most guys have to work a long time to be able to get a nice one. The thing we covet the most, and for a diamond to be produced, it must first go through extreme heat. Extreme heat. Extreme pressure. Are you hearing what I'm telling you? For a diamond to be produced, it has to go through extreme pressure. Extreme heat. And if that wasn't enough, what makes a diamond is the cut. So you are put through, if you want to be a diamond, you must go through extreme pressure. If you can't take pressure, then you're not a diamond. After you go through all the pressure you thought you could not handle and you think it's over, then they turn on the heat. Of all the stuff I've gone through in my life, eating out of trash cans, sleeping in abandoned buildings. The worst thing that ever happened is when I went to the hospital and they told me my wife had a chronic illness and she might not be able to walk one day. People say, E.T., ask CJ, it never broke me. Why? Because I've been broken so much. I've been defeated so much. I've been disappointed so much in my life that I know what it feels like and I can handle it. It didn't happen to me at 19. It didn't happen to me at 20. It didn't happen to me at 30. It happened to me at 40. After I had been through all the pressure I thought I could go through, life said, you finished with all the pressure? I said, yeah. And said, let me bring on the heat. And then when I went through the pressure and the heat, y'all, I thought it was over. The Creator said, now you ready to get cut? You say you wanted to be great, son. You say you wanted to travel the world. You say you wanted to help people, inspire people. Then you gotta be a diamond. But listen to me very closely if you've ever studied the diamond. Once it goes through that type of pressure and it finally becomes a diamond, at that point you can't break it no more. Are you hearing what I'm telling you? Once you get to that point, you cannot be broken anymore. And the only way they could tell if a diamond is a diamond or if it's fake is by applying pressure is how they tell. They don't just look at it. You think you just look at the thing. Like I looked in the thing. They'll just bring it here. Bah, put it on some glass. Bah, okay, it's real. So I'm being honest with you. I'm not giving you the seven principles to. I'm trying to tell you the very first thing I want to tell you before we go through the principles. Say it's going to be a dog fight. And if you soft, this ain't you want to get out now. This is where you're like, I quit. But if you're willing to say, I'm not going to quit, I guarantee you whatever success you want to have, you're going to have it. All right, so here's number one. I apologize. It took a long time to get to number one. Number one, Denzel Washington, you must be very intentional and deliberate. You must be very intentional and deliberate. The stuff that you wrote down on that piece of paper is not going to happen by osmosis. You're not going to wake up one day and find a law degree. You're not just going to walk out of your house, oh, there it is with my name on it. I'm a doctor now. It suddenly appeared. It's not going to work like that. If you're married, it's not going to. If you're married, I promise you, I've been married over 26 years. If you're going to have a good relationship, you're going to have to work for it. If you have a business, you're going to have to work for it. If you have a healthy relationship with your children, but I've made up in my mind that nothing's going to stop us from having a daily relationship. I will do whatever it takes, make whatever adjustments I need to make. So it's going to be a dog fight, but I'm telling you from personal experience, you don't have to start with anything. I'm a living example. You don't have to have anything to get started, not even a daddy. No, I'm being real with you. Not a bank account, not a name, not a camera. We didn't have a camera when we first started. Not even business cards. We still don't have business cards. People say, how are you so successful without business cards? I don't know. We just say, here, take our number down. If you're serious, just here. Here's my number. Call me. So number one, you need to be very intentional and deliberate. I'm going to give you three, four things. I'm letting you go. The first one is you need to be very intentional and deliberate. And what I mean by very intentional and deliberate is, please, you have to hear this. I believe in rugby that both teams are professionals, correct? Listen to me, both teams are professional. Both guys have, you know, started young and are all physically able to play the game. But what happens is you have one team that's good in spurts. You have another team that's dominant. Come on, hear what I'm telling you. When I say I need you to be intentional and deliberate, hear me, I want to paint the picture. You have one team that has the ability to score. They have the ability to do well. They have the ability to score on the opponent. What their challenge is that they can't do it, they can't sustain it. The teams that are dominant, all black, dominant, because they can do it from beginning to end. Right, listen to me, and they can do it team after team after team, right? They can do it over and over and over. They dominate because they put pressure on you from the time you start to the very end. Like, oh, even when they're up, they continue to dominate. And your problem is you're not intentional and deliberate. You wake up on Monday, you might be strong, but by Wednesday, somebody told me, E.T., it's Wednesday, it's hump day. I thought every day was hump day. It's hump day. I thought Sunday was hump day. I thought Sunday is where you really get started. Are you hearing what I'm telling you? You're not intentional and deliberate. You are hoping that the best is going to happen to you, and the best never happens to you. Listen to me very closely. As a Christian, I remember going to God and crying out and saying, I'm doing all the right stuff. I'm doing all the right stuff. I'm not hurting nobody. I'm finding folks' wallet, and I'm finding a way to get their wallet back. I'm not disrespecting females. Like, I'm trying to do all the right stuff. Why am I broke? And God said, being a good person, son, has nothing to do with making money. That's absolutely, you're a good person, and you're going to be rewarded for that. Ask CJ, I can lose my computer, and somebody's going to send it back to me. I lose stuff all the time. I'm like, all right, I'm not going to lose people, but I'll lose stuff. It's like, it's not that deep. Listen to me. I'll leave money, not even in a wallet, just money sitting there. And I'll come back and somebody said, did you lose some money? I'm like, it didn't even have my name on it. Like, I'm being honest. The Beats by Dre, I left them on the plane the other day, did some work, came back. I just randomly walked up to 48, exit gate 48, randomly just walked up and said, I lost some headphones. And he said, oh, are they black with red? I said, yeah. He said, I think that they're down in the security. I'm like, security? That's 2 miles from here. I got to catch a plane another 15 minutes. He said, oh, I'm sorry. What's your name? I said, Eric Thomas. He said, oh, they're right here. We're talking about in Los Angeles, California. I randomly walk up to a gate and this guy just happens to have my... So God said to me, good stuff is always going to happen because you're going doing good stuff. Money's not going to come to you because you're not doing money stuff. Come on, you got to hear what I'm telling you. He said you got to be intentional and deliberate about money stuff. You got to create a product that people need, and you got to give it to them regularly. Like, thank God on Monday for the last 8 years, you just got to keep giving it to them. And the first year, nothing. The second year, nothing. The third year, a little something. The fourth year, a little bit more. By the fifth year, boom, you're a household name. You got to be intentional and deliberate, whether you're making money or not making money. You got to decide that you're going to do something, and you got to do it every Monday, every Tuesday, every Wednesday, every Thursday. The problem with some of you in this room, you're not intentional and deliberate. You're a good person that just hopes the good stuff is going to happen to you. So you need to be on Facebook, because Facebook, they're not just good people. They do the analytics and tell you who's watching your stuff and who's not watching it. They give you the numbers. Hear what I'm saying. If you are intentional and deliberate. So I wake up every single day. See, I don't care what country I'm in. I don't care how long we've been on the flight. I don't care what our schedule is. 2:30. What time do I wake up every day, see? Okay, when we were in Poland, what time did I wake up? Okay, what about England? What about Australia? Are you hearing what I'm saying? I'm intentional and deliberate. I don't care what time zone we are. I just sent my family to time. I'm in New Zealand. I'm looking at what time it is at home and said yesterday. I said yesterday. I like this. I need to be a bad man. I said it's yesterday. -18 hours. And I'm still getting up at the exact same time. CJ, did we work out since we've been here? We just finished working out. How long did I run on the treadmill? Nothing changes. Nothing changes, guys. I'm very intentional. And some of you could be so, you'd be so much better if you just didn't leave things a chance. Eric, what are you saying? I thought you were a man of faith. I am. Faith without works is dead. They kind of go together. Faith, works. Not one of them by themselves don't work magically. You can't work your way to it. You can't faith your way to it. It's a beautiful blend. Of faith, I believe the plane is going to land in Australia, but I still got to get on it. Of faith, I believe that people are going to show up. Like, we're taking a chance. We don't know if people are going to register and come. We're here. We're in Melbourne. We're in Brisbane. We're in Perth. We're in Sydney. We don't know that people are going. I brought my wife. If I crash with my wife, that's it for our leg. Are you hearing what I'm telling you? So faith is great. We believe we're going to get here. We believe things are going to work out. But I still got to get on a plane. I still got to land. I still got to work out. I still got to do TGIM. We still got to do the podcast. Like, nothing changes because I'm in a different country and I'm in today or tomorrow. I'm literally in tomorrow right now. Need you to write this down. How can you be more intentional and deliberate about your life? And when you get home, you're going to answer it for me. All right, two more things. I'm going to let you guys get out of here. I promise. I need you to be intentional and deliberate. Do we do the podcast at a different time every week? Same time. Do we do Thank God It's Monday on Wednesday? As a preacher, do I have my services on Thursday? Same thing every... Come on, guys. I'm not trying to make this deep. I'm trying to make this as simple as I can. When you leave this room, you're going to go to a whole nother level. A year from now, 2 years from now, 3 years from now, Denzel walked in and said, 16 seconds. Clem. Principle number two, he was aware, heightened sense of awareness. You need a heightened sense of awareness. Some of you are making the same mistakes over and over and over and over and over and over and over. I need you to have a heightened sense of awareness. When he walked in a room, before he moved, he studied. And many of you in this room, you are moving and then studying. And you keep making the same mistakes over and over and over and over again. Come on, hear what I'm telling you, making the same mistakes over and over and over. And I remember crying, why are these guys, motivational speakers, traveling all over the world? And I don't get to travel all over the world. I'm trying to do right by people. I'm speaking all over the world. What's going on? And as I did my homework, I said, oh, Eric, you're doing something wrong. You are motivating and they're empowering. You're just telling your story, but you're not making the connection between their life and your story. There are no principles. You're not principle driven. There's not enough content in that. I didn't cry or complain. I just looked at my life and said, E.T., you need to make some adjustments. But that only happens when you have a heightened sense of awareness. So do me a favor. At least an hour a day of every day, you need to be reflecting on what you're doing good and what you're not doing good. Now, we can break that up if you want to. If you want to break that up into 20 minutes in the morning, 20 minutes for lunch, 20 minutes at night, you want to do a half hour in the morning, a half hour at night, I don't care. I just don't want you to make the same stupid mistakes over and over and over again and call it life. I don't want you to keep doing dumb stuff and say, my life is miserable. No, your life is not miserable. Your reflection time is miserable. Your ability to edit, to make adjustments, to make corrections is messed up.
There are two types of people in the world. There are people who spoil people and people who looking to get spoiled. The people who looking to get spoiled, you are dispensable. We can get rid of you. We don't need you. I'm just keeping it 100. I ain't trying to. You broke because you broke. You broke because you don't add enough value. I just told you, because that's how much value I add. I came to New Orleans. I'm going out to eat. The lady at the doggone restaurant, I ain't never been here before. Where did we go yesterday? Somebody tell me it started with an M. I forgot the name. Morris. I went in. The owner of the store was pissed. You sat and ate in my. Nobody told me. They were supposed to tell me before you came. She was pissed. You already paid the bill. Brian told me that you was coming. He told me he was going to tell you. Why didn't he tell? She was pissed. I had so much value to the world that the owner of a restaurant that I've never met before was pissed that I paid to eat in her restaurant. Because I took the opportunity from her to be a blessing. And the dudes from the city tried to pay and I paid. They was like, how did you pay? You're not even from here. We gave her our credit card and told her don't pay. I'm like, bro, you young with it. You young on the get adding value tip. You young with it. I'm a vet. He's like, what do you mean? But we gave her a credit card. I said, I gave her my credit card too and told her I was a pastor and the Lord was going. I said, who you want to deal with, my man or the Lord? Now, God got a blessing for you if you're obedient. You take this card here, you hear me? Y'all not hearing what I'm saying. I could have let my man feed me every day. He's been taking us out. I could have let him feed me. He fed me once. I'm like, enough. You're not going to add more value to me, because if you add more value, you're not going to want me to be in your presence. I will fight you to add value in your life. You like, why you broke? Because you take. That's why you broke. You a taker. That's why you broke. You're not broke because you broke. You broke because of what you do. You are always looking for opportunities to get something for free. I'm not crazy. Everybody wants something for free. But that's average thinking. What makes you great is not you say you great. What makes you great is that you look for opportunities to add value. I want you to hear what I'm saying. CJ not with me because I'm a taker? No, here's the deal. You're not hearing what I'm saying. You saying you want to be great. No, you don't. You want to be paid. You don't want to be great. You want to be seen. You want to be seen. You don't want to sacrifice. You want to be seen. You want people to know your name. You want your name in lights. Oh, you're not hearing what I'm saying. The why you not rich is because why would God make you rich? It's all for you. None of your check, none of your increase don't go to nobody but you. All of our extra stuff goes to them. I get paid off my speaking. I don't get paid off other stuff like that. And Josh came in and was like, E, you're going to have to at least do this or do that. I'm like, okay, whatever you tell me to do, I'll do it. But I can make money off of speaking. The reason why you are not blessed, because all your money go to you. Why would God need to bless you? It ain't going nowhere else. You have enough for you. You don't need millions if you're just looking out for yourself. You need millions when you're taking care of the insurance of other people. So the first thing I want you to do is be honest before you leave this room. If you are not where you want to be, it's because you're not adding value. I want you to think about where you're not adding value. Your wife is not mad at you because you're adding a whole bunch of value. Your wife ain't asking for no divorce because you just the number one husband of the year. That's not why she's asking for a divorce. Are you hearing me? She's asking for a divorce and you're upset, but she's looking at the energy that you give your job, and when you come home, you do not give her the same energy. That's why she's upset. Because she know you got it, because when you go to work, you pouring it out. But when you get home, now you got to take a nap. When you get home, you can't have a conversation. When you get home, you can't help with the kids. So in her mind, she's saying, man, my man killing at the job, but I want to be the job. I'll never forget the worst thing Didi ever said, the worst thing Didi ever told me. We've been together 33 years. Didi cut me like a knife. We were probably about 21, 22. I had come home about 2, 3 o'clock in the morning. I was on campus with my little Christian ministry. Jesus, I was saving souls for Christ, killing the game. Wasn't doing no schoolwork, but Jesus, I was representing Jesus with a 1.0 GPA. I represent Jesus. Jesus is coming. He better come, because with that GPA, you ain't about to get no job. I was all in for God, wasn't doing my schoolwork, came home 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning, and Didi was just quiet. I was like, what's up, boo? Gave her a kiss. I was all pumped. I could tell her mood was bad. I was like, boo, what's wrong? She's like, what do you mean what's wrong? I said, what's wrong? She said, you don't know what's wrong? I said, no, what's wrong? She said, man, you know what? I'm not mad that I married you, because I want to be with you, but I wish I could divorce you and just be your friend again. Because our relationship was way better when we was friends. Cut like a knife. Not that I don't want to be with you. I love you, but I don't get you no more. Once I became your wife, now I'm like secondary now. I wish we were friends, because when we was friends, you was running up behind me. When we was friends, you was calling me all the time. When we was friends, you was taking me to lunch. Now that I'm your wife, like I'm here when you finish doing everything else. So let me tell you something. If your bank account is low in any part of your life, it's my friend, because you're not adding value. So stop right now. Write that down. Where you're not adding value at, or where you're not adding enough value. Write it down. Don't be scared. Write it down. You are. It's an indicator that you are not adding value. If you had 5 friends and you had to get rid of one of them, you already know which one you're getting rid of. Don't play. You know which one you're letting go of. You ain't dumb. You're like, oh, yep, that one. Yep, gotta go. And that's the one that's not adding the most what? The one that's adding the most value, they ain't going nowhere. Talk to me. Who's a person in your life that adds as much value that you add to your own life? Your brother. Yep, you can't let him go. Who's adding the most value in your life? Your daughter. Good. Who's adding the most value in your life? You. Who's adding the most value in your life? You. Who's the person that, quiet as kept, you on some friendship stuff, but you could cut them and it wouldn't kill you? Good. He said, I got several. Good. I just want you to think about those people that's in your life. Like, you love them, but if you cut them, I promise you it wouldn't change your life. And then I want you to think about who are you in that person's life? You're spending so little time with your wife, if she divorced you right now, it wouldn't bother her. It wouldn't hurt you. Okay, so this is how I know if my mom died, it would be rough. That if my biological father died, it wouldn't be as rough. I'm just gonna help y'all. I like to keep it simple. We're gonna bring the deep people on in a minute. If my mom died, it wouldn't be because she's my mom that it would hurt me. It would be because every other day I get that itch and I gotta call my mom and talk to my mom. I talk to my father on Saturday. From 6 to 6:15. And by 6:13, it's kind of, hey, see, it's crazy. See, by 6:15, it's like, you finished. Like, how are you? How are you? How was your week? How was your week? How's your wife? How's your wife? How's my brother? How's your son? At about 15 minutes, we go, that script is check, 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 check. So if I put him in the grave, while I would be hurt that he gone, we don't talk enough where I'd miss him. I just want to keep it, can I make it plain? If I put my mom in the grave, we talk on the reg. I see her Thanksgiving. I see her Christmas. I see her on her birthday. She calls me on my birth. Are you hearing what I'm trying to explain? Who are the people in your life that if you let them go, it wouldn't cost you anything? But more importantly, who are you to those people that you don't add enough value that they need to keep you around? That's what poverty is. That if you're in my life or not, you don't make such a significant impact that it doesn't make a difference if you're there or not. And the question is, what are you going to do about it? If I left the earth right now, it'd be some people that would be hurt that they can't come to another conference and feel that energy. I want to show y'all something. Watch this. All right, let's go to the next one. I want to show y'all something. It's going to blow your mind. All right? So, period. Rich, having value. Natural resource. So just to be rich means you have resources. Does that make sense? So don't look at it as money. It's resources. Now watch this. I'm about to make y'all, this thing is so practical. I called Carl the other day, y'all. Watch this. I called Carl the other day. I was like, yo, Carl, I just need to know how many videos we got up, how many hours of videos we got up. Boom. Watch this, y'all. Go to the next slide. Watch this, y'all. We got 10 years of content if we never do anything else. Yo, this blew my mind. I did the math. We got over 3,000 videos. We're not including podcasts. We're not talking about audiobooks. We're not talking about mixtapes. If you just took one of our pieces of content a day and listened to it for a day, just one piece of content, it would take you 10 years to get through it. And that's not the stuff we're doing right now. It would take you 10 years to get through it. And watch this. This was really going to blow your mind. That's all our free content. You ain't got to pay for none of that. Oh, you not hearing what I'm saying? You ain't got to pay for none of that. That's all free. I guarantee you ain't no other motivational speaker in the world can tell you they got 10 years of content up that's absolutely free. That you don't even got to come to a conference if you don't want to get that ET juice. 10 years, and you want to know why we so successful? Because we got 10 years of content, and millions of people are eating on it every single day, and you want to know why you broke? You're broke because you don't have enough stuff to give other people. You barely got enough stuff for yourself and your own little family. Rich means that you're rich in natural resources, that you have not just enough for yourself, but you have enough for others. It's pressed down. It's pressed down. It's shaken together. It's running over. I'm going to tell you again what it looks like. It's pressed down. It's shaken together and it's running over. It's saying no to $28,000 and not even sweating it. Knowing that in God's time, you're going to wake up and in 24 hours later, you're going to double it. Because you're that valuable to somebody that they... I want you to write that down. The people that are closest to you, write their names down. I know you ain't gonna have a lot of time, but write their names down at least. And then I want you to ask yourself, who are the people that are outvaluing you?
I just want you to do me a huge favor, because This is a serious moment for me, and what makes this moment serious for me is that I'm sitting in a room of people who have the ability to make their dreams become a reality. And we live at a time and live in a country where we can make that dream a reality. And you have to understand that there are times that I speak, for instance, in prisons. And I'm talking to individuals who will spend the rest of their lives in prison and they don't have options. They don't have a lot of choice. That what I do when I come in is I provide a sense of hope and I provide some inspiration, but I'm not able to help them to bring about the change that they want to see happen. And I'm so excited to be in this room because the words that I say in this moment can fuel the rest of your life. Right, so I'm so excited. Like for me, this isn't I won't ask you for anything over the next hour other than the things that are gonna take you to the next level. But I'm excited because when I leave, we may never see each other again, but I have the ability when you walk out of this room to make you operate in a way you've never operated before. And once you do that, because I know if you're in this room, I know there's something special about you, that once you leave this room and you go from 70 to 120%, there are gonna be some things that happen in your life that didn't happen before, not because you didn't have the ability. So this is not an ability room. Like we're not talking about ability. We're talking about activating this greatness that's in us. Your abilities are your abilities. I'm not gonna be able to help you to do anything that you do better. Like I'm not gonna be able to give you a gift that you don't have. But what I will be able to do is help you today operate in a way you've never operated before. Right? I will help you to operate in a way you've never operated before. I'm gonna help you to do some things that you've never done in your life before. And as a result, you're gonna be able to go to a whole new level. So this is, we have to start here. We have to start here. Just write down those things, one or two or three things that you have to desperately get done before this year ends. It's desperation. I don't have a choice. I don't have an option. You got to get that done. Got it. Like, I just want you, and I'm not talking about stuff that's kind of important. I'm talking about the stuff that has got it. The ball's dropping and you can't keep talking about it. Like, you will not be able to rest if you didn't get this done. I want you to write that down. I want you to write that. That's where we're starting. I want you to write that down. E.T., like, I got to get this done, E. Like, E, this is no option. This is not like a vacation. This is not, you know, just making a couple more dollars for the sake of buying a car, a house. Like, E, this is some life and death stuff, E. Like, this is some change the trajectory of my life stuff, E. This is like, it's gonna put me in a place like where I'm just gonna be able to get to that place that I've been trying to get to. I want you to write that down. And it was, look guys, I'm being honest. It was like random. It was like just totally random. It was out of nowhere. It was the Christmas holiday, and Carl, our videographer, had his family over, and we live around, at that time, we lived around the corner from each other. Now we live on the same block. Random, right? Christmas was over. We're just going to the house, just eating dinner. It just was a random night. And somehow we got to talking, and Carl's wife is from Barbados, and she didn't have citizenship. So unfortunately, she was in the States without citizenship, and so she had to stay in school in order to eventually get her citizenship. So she did her master's degree, you know, and she was in her PhD, and it was weird. It was just like, yo, E.T., I don't know how it happened, but it was like, yo, E.T., my wife is gonna get her degree before you get yours, right? I'm an American citizen. Like, I had already been in the program for a few years, and, you know, she, and it was, I don't know, but have you ever heard, like, you know when it's your time? Like, you know, it's that moment. It's like, enough is enough. I can't tell you. People have asked me before, Eric, when you get your PhD? I'm like, I'll get it done. E.T., how far are you in the process? Finish all my coursework. I just got to write the dissertation. But it was something about that night that was different. It was almost the end of the year. And I remember Carl, listen to me very closely, guys. I'm being real with you. I didn't even have a conversation with Carl. Like, we never even talked about it afterwards. I never said anything to him about it, but I felt this guilt. I felt like this embarrassment. Like, and for real, he wasn't like speaking directly to me. He was just saying, you know, hey, E, I think my wife's probably gonna finish her degree before you finish yours. And I'm talking about like it pierced. And I just remember like we were talking afterwards and I didn't hear anything. Like, for real, have you ever been in a conversation and it just shifts and somebody's talking to you and like you can't hear the words that are coming out of their mouth? I didn't hear anything he said. I just kept it like, E, when are you gonna get this done, E? Like, yo, E, are you ever going to finish this? And it's not about a degree, but are you ever going to finish this? Like, are you going to get it done? And I remember excusing myself, like, all right, Carl, hey, great time. Love you guys, gotta go, gotta get up in the morning. And I'm telling you guys, it's not even a 5-minute walk and it felt like an hour. All I could think about when I was going home was like, enough is enough. Like, I'm through, I'm gonna get this done. Okay, just help me out. You're in the room. You ever had that enough is enough moment? Raise your hand for me. You had that enough is enough moment, right? So I need you to be there. Like the next 30, 40 minutes, I need you in that space. That enough is enough. I'm not dumb. Like, I can get a PhD. Has nothing to do with that. It has everything to do with the fact that I just didn't say, all right, this is the year. Right? And so that thing you wrote down, I need you to do me a huge favor. I don't know if you have a pen or a piece of paper. I don't even know if you can do this on your phone, but I want you to kind of put a year next to that for me. Put a year. I want you to just put a year on that for me. Like, don't make up, like, don't do it for me. A real number. Just give me like a real, real solid number, right? And I remember saying to myself, like, yo, if we come back next year for Christmas and your family's here, I remember saying to myself, we come back this time next year, I'm gonna be Dr. Thomas. We come back to your house next year. As a matter of fact, I will pay for your parents to come. Like, I want to reinvent this whole like scenario again next year. Like, I want everybody here. Let's do the same meal. Let's sing the same songs. Let's Twilight Zone this thing out. I want it to be exactly like it was, except for this time, I want you to say Dr. Thomas. Like, this is going on in my mind. I'm not having a conversation with anybody. And I'm saying, like, this is it, guys. This is it. And so I put a date on it. I put a date. I said 2015. 2015, we're not going to have this conversation. 2015 is time next year. I'm finished. It's done, right? Good. So now I need you to do me a favor. I need you to put a month next to it. Yeah, I need you to put a month next to it now. You got January all the way to December. I need you to put a month on it for me. Give me a month. Yeah, I need you to put a month on it for me, right? Right now, as you're writing the month down, what I want you to think about is, okay, so write this down too. I'm sorry. I know you came to listen, not do a lot of writing. I apologize, but I really need this. I really need this. I really need this. I really need this. I need you to write down three people you love next to those goals. Three people you love, just three people, right? Give me the name, write the names down. I don't put son, mom, or give it to me, right? Write their names down. Now, this is what I need you to think about. What I need you to think about is how this goal or these goals will revolutionize their lives. Like, I really want you to think about, okay, you can do this later. When you get home, you can do this later. But I want you to write down for each one of them, give me three ways. Please do this when you get home. If you really love them, like you say you love them. When you get home, I need you to write their names down. And I need you to write down when you get to this place, when you finally make this thing happen, how is it going to empower them? How is it going to change their life? And all I can think about is, wow, if I get this PhD, like I can just like change the zeros. Like, I just remember thinking, like, there were doors that were closed to me in the United States of America, right? Because of the nationality that I come from or the part of town that I come from. And I specifically remember people picking other people over me for speaking engagements that weren't as good as I was. I remember people using the excuse of you're not qualified enough. And I remember the PhD, we're going to solve all of that. Like, no more ET ain't qualified. No more, like, we're going to pick this bird over this bird. Like, nope. This PhD is going to open doors for me that were once closed, which means it's going to open doors for my daughter, which means it's going to open doors for my wife, which means it's going to open doors for my mother, which means it's going to open doors for CJ, which means it's going to open doors for Carl. And so every day when I woke up, I remembered the people that this degree would affect. And so the days I did not feel like studying, the days I did not feel like writing, the days I wanted to sleep on a plane, I thought about CJ and his family. I thought about Carl and his family. And I said, E.T., keep going. Listen to me very closely. The reason why you stop and start, and you stop and you start, and you stop and you start, is because the goal is not meaningful enough. There's something about the goal that if you quit, it's not going to hurt nobody. If you quit, it's not going to change nothing. If you quit, it's not that deep. Look, this is what I need you to do. So immediately when I left that house and I made up in my mind that I was going to get the PhD, I remember immediately doing a TGIM saying, all right, it's over. It's over. A year from now, I will be Dr. Thomas. And I just didn't speak it into the atmosphere. I spoke it to people who will hold me accountable. Write it down. Who's going to hold you accountable? Who's going to hold you accountable? Who's that person? Who's that person? And some of you have been a part of the real estate program. Some of you just come to hear me. When you leave, I need you to call that person, that guy, that young lady, that mother, or that father. Like, I need you to call that person and say, yo, I got to do these three things before this month and before, yep. And this is who I'm doing it for, and this is why I'm... So just somebody real quick over here, because we gotta make this real. Somebody over here real quick, we gotta make this real. Somebody tell me, who's that person you're calling over here? Who's that person you're calling? Who's that person that on this side, that person who's gonna hold you accountable? Who's that person? You've identified that person, and as you raise your hand for me, tell me who that person is. Yes, sir, who's that person? Good. Look, I need you to hear me. Here's the last step, and we're moving forward. The last step is I need you to identify that person. And I identified that person. After I went on YouTube and said, hey, guys, I'm marching. Matter of fact, I turned it into an event. Listen to me very closely. I rented out a space. I put the deposit down. I tasted the food. Like, we did a tasting. I decided what food we were going to eat. The linen. We had to decide what linen. This is 8 months before I even graduated. Never forget, one of the professors came to me and said, E.T., there's a lot of paperwork to fill out. We got about 2 or 3 months left, but I'm just going to be honest with you. You waited on some things because you weren't in school, and now you're back, but I just don't think you're going to be able to make it happen. And I laughed. I chuckled. She said, no, I'm serious. There's a format, and there's a way, and there's some, and you didn't, and it takes this month for this long, 30 days for this, 6 weeks for that, and you just didn't put your paperwork in time. And I said, ma'am, I'm sorry, but you don't get it. I called my grandma and told my grandma I was graduating. Like, no, I'm being serious. Like, I called my grandma, and my grandma said, baby, you know I'm on a fixed income. So if I buy this ticket, grandma can't get her money back. I said, ma'am, I told my grandma that I was graduating, and my grandma already called her hairstylist and told her how she wanted her hair to look. Grandma went out and bought a dress. My grandma bought a dress for the graduation. And you got to hear what I'm saying, because you're listening to me, but you're not listening to me. Listen to what I'm trying to tell y'all. I'm being real with y'all. My biological father wasn't in my life. Hear what I'm saying. My mother hid from me who my biological father was, yet my grandmother's always been in my life. That don't go together. My grandmother said to my mother, if you want to hide the identity of his father, that's cool, but you can't take my grandson from me. And so ever since I've been a kid, my grandma been to everything. She's never missed anything. And when my grandma called, she said, you better make sure you graduate, baby, because I'm coming. And so what I'm trying to tell you is, I didn't get the degree to get the degree. I got the degree because I called my grandma. I'm trying to tell you the reason why you're not doing it is not because you don't have what it takes to do it. Not because you don't have the ability to do it. But whatever it is you say you're going to do, the meaning is not strong enough. Somehow the meaning is not strong enough. You've not put enough value in it. You don't have enough skin in it. You played around with it so much that you don't have nothing to lose if you don't do it. What I'm telling you is, you got to create the type of scenarios, not the goal, the type of scenarios that if it doesn't work, you lose everything. And because you cannot lose everything, you got to make it happen. Glenn came all the way from Australia. You can't plan your graduation in 2 weeks. You can't buy a ticket from Australia and then call somebody and say, Glenn's not going to happen now. Was that a refundable? Did you get a refundable ticket? So I need you to put some value, because if you put 120% value in it, 120% meaning in it, and you get 120% accountability on it, every single goal you write down is going to happen. So you got like a 4-cylinder, you got a 6-cylinder, you got an 8-cylinder. I hear there's even a 12-cylinder, right? What's the difference between a 4-cylinder, 6-cylinder, 8-cylinder? What's the difference? Say it again. That's deep. Yeah. Yep, that's deep, right? Power. I like that, right? And so when you think about power, what can you do with power? A whole bunch of stuff, right? So what happens then is, based on what you tell me, that's going to determine what kind of engine you're working with. So we all got skill. Everybody, like, what position do you play? Good. Give me the average, you know, like, height for a center. 6'10", give me some dimensions. 6'10", 7'2", wingspan. Good. What about weight? Good. So the average dude that's playing center, he ain't 6'4". If he's 6'4", he ain't doing what?
He's not playing center. So every center pretty much looks alike. So what's the difference between the centers? That's the difference between two dudes who play a center. If y'all both got the same skill set, what's going to separate you is the will. That's what's going to separate you. And will is power. So everybody got the same skill set, but what separates you is the will. That's what separates you. That's when you got two dogs that come up against each other, somebody got to take an L and somebody taking a W, right? So first half, second half, that's what happens. So then how do we create power? We create power by our drive, by our engine. That's how we create power. So that's why I ask you, what do you want? Now, I'm gonna be real. I ain't got no reason to lie to y'all. The average person that I talk to say championship, and they say NBA. Y'all, you said something deeper than that. Matter of fact, bro, you really said it. The average dude that's in the league don't even wanna be in the league, bro. The average dude in the league ain't trying to play 82 games, right? What else is he not trying to do? Let's be real. 82 games. What else is he not trying to do? Some of you not trying to do? You love the game, but what are you not trying to do? I'm not trying to go to recovery. Bottom line, I don't feel like being in recovery. What else? Workouts, good. What else? Travel, what else? Say it again. Practice, film, weight. You feel what I'm saying? Like, let's just keep it 100, bro. Most of us ain't trying to do that. You feel me? So when cats say, I want to go to the NBA, no, you don't. You want to take care of your mama. That's what you want to do. Because if you can make $40 million without going to the league and make $40 million going to some school every day helping a group of kids, and you can get up and go whenever you wanted to, you can do one day a week, 2 days a week, go train them. Which one would you do? The league for 82 games, practice, injury, travel. Which one would you take? Same 40 mil. Going to the kids. It ain't rocket science. So let's be 100. Most of us ain't trying to do this. Right? So if we're not trying to do it, what happens is when you do it the first half, you do it a little bit, maybe a little lot, then you get the second half, then it get hard, then you quit. You're like, I ain't trying to do this. Now, you might not say you quitting, but you're not giving 120%. Does that make sense? All right, so let's do this. Y'all got to be fair. And one of y'all tell the truth. How many of you have been in the game and somewhere in the game, you lost interest in the game? Just be honest. One person, you played a game and you lost interest. Let me see your hands. Just lost interest. And so when you lose interest, you lose what? You lose power. That's what happens. So you lost interest. You're like, I ain't really trying to be here. So you lost power. So the reason why I'm asking you, what do you want? Because if you know what you want, that can drive you. So you say, who said they want to take care of their mama? Good, you want to take care of your mama. What is that? Where you from? St. Paul, Minnesota. Good. And when you say take care of your mama, what does that look like? Love it. Love it. So, and again, we're just going to be honest. It's a small group. How many times have you practiced and played the game and watched film that you really think about that and had that at the front of your mind? Bingo. I asked him. He was like, he ain't even his mama. He was like, I've definitely not had it on the front of my mind. You feel me? So what happens when you put it in the front of your mind, you go from a 4-cylinder to a 12-cylinder. And here's the crazy part. The cylinders are in you, but when you're not interested, you go to a 4 instead of a 12. And what my job is to find a way to make the best you show up. Does that make sense? How many games do you play? So my goal is to make your will show up for 35 games. Because if your will shows up for 35 games, you're going to beat the average team because they just come in with what? They just come in with skill, bro. And they too don't want to be there. And they too don't want to practice. And they too, out of everything, which one you hate the most? Let's be real. Which one out of what you have to do in basketball, which one do you hate the most? Practice. And you got to do that more than anything else. Isn't that crazy? Like the one thing you hate, that's the thing you got to do the most of. It ain't like you playing the most of the time. You only playing how many days a week? 2 days a week. How many hours? 2 hours. That's it. You play 4 hours tops. How many hours you practicing? You can't even think. He like, I don't know. I just saw a look of disgust. My man was like, I can't even count it. So you see the problem we have here? We got a problem. We got a problem with you skilled enough, but maybe you're not willed enough. Does that make sense? All right, we good? Does that make sense? Good. So we got to ask the question, what drives you? What? Write that down. What drives me? What drives me? And every day when you wake up, I need you to tap into that power.
Now, there are a couple things that drive me. So the first thing that drive me, and if you know my story, don't say nothing, but I left the crib at 16. The very first time I ran away from home, I was like between 12 and 13. I called my mom, right? Because the person that was raising me was 6'8". And as you can tell, I'm not 6'8". You feel me? I ain't even start growing. Like, I had a growth spurt at 16, and you could tell it wasn't a big one. You feel me? Like, it wasn't a lot, right? So imagine how short I was in high school. So people used to tell me all the time, like, yo, bro, I ain't trying to be funny, but you know that ain't your father, don't you? I was like, well, you know that ain't your father. I said, that's my father. That's not your father. I'm like, yeah, it's my father. Because if it wasn't my father, who would have told me? My mom would have told me it wasn't my father. She ain't never said nothing. So it's got to be my father. You know what I'm saying? That's my sister. That's my sister. So I think I was about 12, almost 13 years old. I called my mom one day at the job. I was like, look, Mom, just be real with me. Just keep it 100. Don't lie to me. Is this man my father? She was like, no, he's not your father. But I was going to tell you. I was like, when? Like 18? 17? Like, when was you going to get to it? She's like, I was going to get to it. So you can imagine when your mama lied to you about your father, like, what do you think happened between me and my mom's relationship? It went down. Why? Because I couldn't what? Good. And what do you think happened to the person that was raising me that I thought was my father? Went down. What do you think I said to myself? You ain't my daddy. Flat out. So I went to school with that mentality the whole nine. So I started running away from the crib when I was 12. I would come back, be gone 3 days, a week, come back. When I was 16, I left for good. When I was homeless for good, you're on the streets of Detroit. There's a lot of stuff that happened. Almost got shot a couple times. A lot of stuff happened, right? So I'm homeless. 16, 17 years old, started hanging out with my boy Bob. Bob started bringing me to church. Like, I'll never forget the first time I went to church. I was like, God, we homeless. What are we going to do? He's like, we not homeless. You homeless. We not homeless. You the one making them crazy decisions. So I remember, you know, being at a revival. Like, I ain't grew up in church. I ain't never seen my mother pray. My father who raised me, I ain't never seen him pray. Like, we didn't go to church. We ain't do that. And I remember my man was preaching. He was just talking about, like, before your mama made you, God knew you were in the womb. Like, for real, you got to understand, I'm 17, bro, 16, 17. If my mom lied to me about who my father was and my mom got pregnant at 17, I'm thinking I'm a what? I'm a mistake. So my whole life, I'm walking around like I'm a mistake, bro. Like, you ain't really want me. You got pregnant at 17 years old. I don't even know why you didn't have an abortion. I messed your life up. You messed my life up. Now I'm about to mess your life up. That's what I was on. When I was about 17, started going to church. The pastor did this thing in Isaiah. It was crazy. My man was like, yo, before your mother knew you, God called you. And I'm like, ooh, that's pretty deep. You know what I'm saying? I'm like, I like that. You know what I'm saying? Because if that's the truth, and I ain't no Christian, I don't really know God like that, but I'm hoping that's the truth, because if it's the truth, then it means what? I'm not a mistake. And if I'm not a mistake, then that means I was born with a what? With a purpose. I was like, ah, let's go. My mom didn't even know. I'm like, let's go. And then the pastor, like, my man would come up to me every week. He was like, yo, E, did you graduate from high school? And I was like, nope. He was like, you need to get your GED and go to college. And I was like, bruh, how am I going to go to college? I ain't finished high school. He was like, just get your GED and I'll write a letter of referral, a recommendation letter. And I was like, is that possible? He was like, yeah. I was like, all right, bet. Start dating this girl at the church. I'll never forget, she was a year younger than me. She came to me one day. I was out of high school for 2 years, bro. My boys were selling dope. We were stealing cars off trucks. We were just doing some crazy stuff. And she came to me. I used to go to church every week. I never missed church. Wednesday night prayer meeting, I walked 2 hours to get there. I never missed church, y'all. Watch this. My girl came to me. She was like, look, I got to tell you something. I was like, what's up? She's like, do you love me? I was like, yeah. I mean, we 18. You know what I'm saying? Like, whatever that means. You know what I'm saying? I love you. But like, what do you mean? She's like, no, do you love me? I was like, I guess. What does that mean? She's like, look, I'm going to college. If you don't go with me, I'm breaking up. I was like, you doing what? She's like, I'm going to break up with you if I go to college. And I ain't stupid. I ain't go to college, but I know if my girl go to college, pretty little red bone. I know if she go to college for 4 years and I stay back in Detroit, what's going to happen? Somebody going to scoop her. I might not be the smartest apple, but I ain't stupid. I went and studied, got my GED, bro. Got in the whip with her and went to college. Flat out, I told the pastor, I was like, yo, bro, are you serious? Can you really hook me up? He's like, I got you. I graduated from there. I'm a pastor. I'm going to write a letter. It's a Christian school. They're going to let you in. Nah, you're going to have to take like remedial classes and stuff, but I can get you in. I'm like, bet. Follow her to college. Got to college, y'all. I'll never forget. I flunked out. I took me 12 years to get a 4-year degree. But I remember the first time they had this Christian like program, and they was like, yo, E, they don't even know me. It was like, we want you to speak. I don't even know how they asked me to speak. It was like something called commencement or something. It was like for freshmen, and one freshman get to address for all freshmen. I got up and got on the mic and preached and was like, whoa. Like, it wasn't even a sermon, but I felt like, just like when you get the rock in your hand, you got all them people in the stand, you got your family in the stand, they got the TV on. Talk to me, bro. When you in that mode, you out there doing your thing, everybody watching, how does that make you feel with that rock in your hand? Invincible, bro. What if you had a football in your hand? Or a soccer ball, how would you feel? You don't even know. But with the basketball, you feel invincible. That's how I felt when I got the mic. When I got the mic in my hand, I was like, whoa, I could do this. And so the first time in my life, I had purpose. So I started getting in the word, and that purpose, it drove me. That like, yo, E, you got to save the world. Like, you the Martin Luther King of 2019. When I wake up, y'all, that's why I wake up so fired up. I'm like, yo, I am the Martin Luther King of this generation. Like, flat out, when older people don't know who I am, I don't be tripping. My man, like, 50, 60, 70 years old, like, I don't know who you are. I'm sure you don't. But if you was 19 and didn't know who I was, if you was 24 and you didn't know who I was, I'd have a problem. Are you hearing what I'm saying? So the NBA player, of course, rocked with me. Chris, CP3 just did a shoe with all my quotes on it. This is my generation. The millennials are mine. I wake up every day doing a video, not to get paid. Don't nobody pay me to do those videos. Why do I do it? Because I got purpose. That's my drive. That's my engine. That's why you see me so pumped up. Because I wake up and like, God got a mission for me. Check. If I wake up, it's showtime. I'm like, God, I just need one favor. Just wake me up. Like, I can't do that on my own. I swear though, if you wake me up, it's a wrap. I'm about to motivate somebody, inspire somebody. I'm about to get somebody through chemotherapy. I'm about to get somebody who got a divorce back together again. I'm about to get some child that ain't talking to their family. I'm about to get them back again. I'm about to get some dude who dropped out the league to get back in the league. I'm about to get some girl who failed her board exam to take it again. Just wake me up. That's that engine. And so for a lot of you, for real, you a 12-cylinder, but you acting like a 4-cylinder because you ain't got no drive. And when you don't have drive and they making you go to practice, well, of course you can't do practice. But if you don't think about practice no more, but you think about who? So what I'm saying to you is, every time you get up and grind, you that much closer. So when you do practice, I don't want you to see practice no more. I don't want you to see practice no more. I want you to see I'm about to cash my mama out. Every playbook, I don't care if you like the playbook or not. He just told you I was Dr. Thomas. I hate school. I hate school. There's nothing about school I like. And I went to Michigan State, which means that I was going to school with minus 10 degrees with 12 inches of snow on the ground. I hate school in January. I hate school in February. I just hate school. I'm a high school dropout. At no point is my degree hanging in my office. Is my degree hanging in the house? You know where my degree is? No, I don't either. That's how much I hate school. I don't even want to see it. I'm being real. Like, I don't even want to see my PhD. I don't even want to be reminded of school. That's how much I hate it. You know why I went and got a PhD? Because if I want to be number one motivational speaker in the world as an African American, I gotta have all the credentials, bro. If I want to be number one, I gotta be better. I gotta do more. It's just real. Ain't nobody tripping. I ain't tripping. You hear what I'm telling you? So, bro, I hate school, but I had to do it. Why? Because I wanted to be number one in the world. And I woke up one day and was like, yo, Tony Robinson making how much? But you know what I realized? I didn't have the language he had. I'm not mad. So I didn't go to school to get a degree. I went to Michigan State to learn the language. And I sat in the class and listened to all them teachers talk. And I was like, ooh, that's how you say it? That's the word you use? You don't say teach, you say pedagogy? Well, pedagogy it is. Let's go. Are you hearing what I'm saying? I'll do whatever it takes to make 50 racks an hour. I'll do whatever it takes to feed my family. I did the 4-year, the master's, the PhD. I hated every minute of it. But I tell you something, I hate school, but I love freedom. I love having my freedom, bro. I love choices. I only fly first class. I was just flying private jet with CP3. I love options, bro. I love options more than I hate school. And at the rate some of you going, you don't like practice. Well, wait till you get a load of real life. I'm not suggesting that you don't work hard in terms of an idea, but I'm trying to tell you, if you grind, 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 you will be broke the rest of your life or you will barely make it. This society
did not become rich by workers. It came rich by the people who knew how to put the workers to work. come on, somebody. I know, ouch, amen, whatever you want to say. It's the truth. This country got rich off of 400 years of not paying nobody. That's how they became rich. It's free labor. You making somebody work for 400 years for free? Yeah, you rich. You ain't got to pay nobody. You ain't got to do insurance. I don't get insurance. I don't even get like paid vacation. I don't even get to take no time off. I'm a slave and I'm sick. You got to go pick cotton. And then if you get sweet with it, Eli Whitney, you get sweet with it and make a machine, you're not about to get the patent to the machine. Your master about to get the patent. And you might get lunch regularly. But you're not about to get paid. Kill that worker's mentality. You value effort over execution. For real. I love it. I love it. The have-nots, you think because you put in 50 hours, even though it was at 70%, you think that's the same thing as execution, and it's not. I was with my wife the other day, and we had, like, look, we just got overwhelmed with it. We never knew that many people was going to buy. Like I said, we don't know who we are in the earth. We know that many people was going to buy the journals. Like, it was just unbelievable. So we all had to, Carl house, my house, we all packing books, putting it up. I promise y'all, the way my wife worked, I was like, yo, I can't do that. I just bowed down to her. I was like, wow, you got MS and still killing me. I bowed down, sweetie. I need a break. You know what I'm saying? I would have been a house Negro. I'm like, I can't do it. You know what I'm saying? I'm just being 100. My wife on some field stuff. I'm like, I can't do it, sweetie. I'm like, no, my wife was like, yo, when those boxes come in, those people ordered it. However many boxes come to our house, they must all be shipped tonight. I was like, boo, we don't even know how many boxes is coming. I said, can we count the boxes first? We have no idea how many boxes coming. We don't even know if we have enough supplies. My wife, that's a different mindset. My wife said when they come in the house, they will be packaged. And whatever post office she found out, one point, I said, the post office closed at 4:30. She said the one in our neighborhood, the one up the street 15, 20 minutes away, it closed at 9:30. I said, how you know that? You know what I'm saying? I only know about the one in the by the neighborhood. She got a different mindset. So a lot of you think for real, like you put in a lot of effort and you looking at your boss like, what's up? But what you don't realize is your boss don't make money off of effort. Your boss make money off of execution. So I watched my wife grind and we got them suckers done and they kept coming in and she kept doing it and I was burnt out. I ended up getting a gig. I was like, praise God, I'm out. I was on the plane, first class, like, thank you, Father, for the break. You know what I'm saying? Bless her heart. Right? You entertainment seeking. E, did you see Power? Absolutely not. Did you see the Game of Thrones? Absolutely not. I'm trying to blow up after the blow up. I'm number one. Now I'm trying to find out what's after number one. And you know what that is? That's not a speaker. That's a businessman. So I'm trying to own as many companies as I can, get as much equity as I possibly can. I don't got time for the Game of Thrones. I'm playing my own games. I'm trying to sit on a throne. You know what I'm saying? I'm trying to get a throne. I'm just saying, for real, some of you broke and you still entertained. Like, I'm not even tripping on those of you who got money and you comfortable and you want to chill and watch it. I'm talking about those of you who are complaining about your job. You ain't got no money and you sitting here complaining about, but then you watching all the TV programs. That's a have-not mentality. The rich person made Game of Thrones. They don't even watch it like you watch it. They can't even enjoy it. They put that Joker together. They watching it like, that didn't come right. Oh, Lord. She didn't say it right. They were off. Oh, man. Okay, next episode. You sitting there in a house that you can't even afford. You in your mama's basement watching Game of Thrones. You just comfortable. I just need to come out right now. See, give me a device on the next one. We can just start hitting folks in the face. Just blah. I need to bring you to your senses. You in your mama's basement watching TV. All right. Pleasure before payment. For real, you like to get, you do things that you can't afford. For real, you do stuff you can't afford. And then you don't understand that this society is built rich off of people who like pleasure before payment. They making money off of you because you buy a car you can't afford and they charge you 5-6 times more for it.
They give you a house that you can't afford, and you thought it was $300,000, but come to find out when you finish paying for it 15, 30 years later, that house wasn't $50,000. Now it's about $700,000. You didn't pay the extra $500,000 for a house. That's not worth it. But they caught you because you was broke. They saw you watching the Game of Thrones. They saw you. No, they laughing. And they think I'm playing. They got you monitored when you watch it. They know your spending habits. This thing is crazy. I wasn't even in Michigan for 4 months. I was on the road. I came back, went to like the Myers, and I just brought one. Hey, I brought one thing, and they gave me coupons for everything I buy. I was like, somebody watching me. How they know I eat that? And I eat that. And I ain't bothered in a while. And they just gave me a coupon for it? They watching you. You just thought the mail came randomly. A car came to your crib, credit card. You're trying to start a business. You're broke. We're about to give you $50,000 at $2 million interest. You didn't read that part. It was so small. You was just geek. I got a credit card. I prayed and the credit card came. No. Don't put that on God. You didn't make your holy credit card holy. I'm sorry. I know, but they getting mad. Let me stop. They don't value delayed gratification. You're undisciplined. Man, if I could go here, but I can't go here. Man, listen to me very closely. A lot of you could be millionaires, but because you're not disciplined, he pulls on a couple. Some of you because you're not sexually disciplined, you've had people take stuff from you and you've been in places and relate. I just saw two young women that lost their lives that was on some dating thing and went to some man. I was just like, yo, where they do that at? Where do you just trust somebody online that you don't even know? What was it about you that you were so had so such a low self-esteem? And it was twins, it was sisters. That you just gonna go to some man's house you don't even know? Come on. Then another young lady just went to jail. Her man told her he killed somebody and she took a saw and saw. I'm like, boo, you about to go to jail? I'm like, wow, is it that love that deep these days? People buying stuff. I'm like, well, you ain't grateful for what God, you gotta get the extra hookups? I ain't mad at you, but if you do that, you understand what you attracting. And then you mad when you ain't attracting a successful man of character and integrity and God, but you're not putting that out. Okay, I'm sorry. All right. Listen to me very closely. Somebody, your zero is going to go to the next level when you can learn to say no. I was just at a function. My man was like, E, you did a phenomenal job, bruh. We doing happy hour at 3:30. I said, my plane leave at 3:50. He said, you're not going to stay for happy hour? I said, bruh, I'm not here for no happy. We don't know each other like that. Happy hour? I came to speak. I didn't come to build no relationship with you. I didn't come to drink with you. Drink? Bro, I don't even drink. And if I drank, I would drink at home. I wouldn't drink in front of you and get loose like that and start talking crazy. You don't need to know me like that. You need to know me as the number one motivational speaker in the world. Flawless. I'm not, but that's what you need to know me as. You don't even need to get close enough to me to know my faults. This is a business transaction. You going doing business with people drinking. Like, y'all, what you being social for? You don't have no discipline. Drink when you get home. You just see some free wine. You see some free alcohol. Drink when you get home. This is business. Boundaries. There are boundaries. My man like, yo, why you got to go? Because I'm married. I got a wife. I'm going home. We finished. We ain't got no more business to do. You told me you wanted a 2-hour presentation. I did it. I'm going home. But E, this is a resort. And I'm going home. Why? Because I can't get in trouble at home. I can't get in trouble at the crib. I can get in trouble at this resort. It's a lot of temptation at this resort. So I'm going home. It's okay to get into temptation at the crib. The bed is undefiled. Like, I can come home and do this. I can't be doing that over there. And many of you are not where you're supposed to be, not because you're not gifted. You have absolutely no discipline.
I remember praying one day. I'm out praying 3 o'clock in the morning. I'm talking to the Creator at 3 o'clock in the morning. And I ain't where I want to be. And I'm like, God, I ain't where I want to be. And he was like, you stop being a victim. That's why you ain't successful. You watching LeBron make his dreams become a reality. You watching the Black Mamba make his dreams become real. If you put the same time LeBron put in, and I start studying, and I realize as an African-American male, I need to get a master's degree and a PhD in order to do what I'm doing. And guess what? I had to get up even though it was hard, and I had to take ownership of my life, take ownership of my time, take ownership of my day.
But what I didn't want to do is I didn't want to wear another man's armor because I didn't know if I could win the fight wearing Saul's suit. I needed my slingshots. I needed my five stones. So when you see this e-slingshot right here, this e-five stones. Why? Because what Saul did didn't even work for him. So a lot of times we copycatting other people and doing what they doing and it ain't even working for them. But because you have a low self-esteem or because you need to be affirmed, you're doing what they want you to do. And I promise you, if I go out, I'm going out E.T.
It's about freedom. I want to be able to get up and walk wherever I want to walk. I want to be able to walk in the neighborhood where I can have my hoodie on, Alex, and not get shot down. I don't run with people who count on me to put up 50 points. I run with people who put up 50 on their own. I put up 50, they put up, and we murder you. Fuck, look, Mike, that's why I respect Mike. If I can kill you, I'm killing you. I'm not giving you life. I'm not giving you no doggone game. I'm murdering you. If you can go and fall, you're going and fall. Mike ain't sweeping one team and then going seven with another team. I'm sweeping everybody. Why? Because I'm putting up 50 every night. I'm not missing no free throws. I'm MJ. I ain't missing Jack. That's who I run with. My people don't miss assignments. My top dogs don't miss assignments. When it's their turn to do what they do it with no flaw. And then I get up when I'm supposed to get up and murder it. You putting up 50 and your squad putting up 12. You don't stand a chance. We got that dog. We ain't reactive.
One-dimensional players, no disrespect, one-dimensional players aren't in the league. One-dimensional players ain't in the league. What made Michael Jordan Michael Jordan is he can put up 30 and he can shut your butt down. He can play offense, he can play defense. He can play 40 minutes, 48 minutes. And most of you in this room, your problem is you're one-dimensional and you're trying to hang your hat on that. So what? I'm the number one motivational speaker in the world. Am I the number one father in the world? My kids don't care nothing about YouTube. My wife don't care nothing about YouTube. So what? You're the number one motivational speaker. Are you the number one husband? When you come home, cut all that foolishness off and give me me. Life punks you. Life punks you and say, do you really want this? I'm gonna give your wife MS. Do you really want this? Five of your aunts gonna die of cancer. Do you really want this? You gonna lose friends. Do you really want this? Your mama gonna be pissed when you write the book about your family. Do you really want this? Do you really want this? Cousins gonna abandon you. People that you used to be like this with gonna think you bougie and don't wanna deal with you. It's a part of it, but I paid too much. If I was gonna quit, I would've quit in the abandoned building when I wanted to commit suicide and take my life. I should've quit when I heard my voice say, your mama don't want you, your own daddy don't want you, take your life. I got through that, so why am I gonna quit over a grade, an F on a grade? Why would I quit because I didn't do well on the master's degree? Come on. And so I'm telling y'all, you have come too far to quit now. You have invested too much to quit now. You have lost too much to quit now. Get a reward for your pain. Now, the second one, which again, I think is the most important one when you really talk about doing business, you have to be competitive. If
For some of you, like, no, can't we all just get along? Can't we just do this together? Can't we just be on the same squad? Absolutely, but you got to be competitive, right? So let me read it, right? Relating to or involving competition, having a strong desire to win. Not a strong desire just to make money, just to pay your bills, just to get by. I didn't make the rules. If you're going to do business in America, you have to play to win. You have to. No part. Now, they giving them out, but they ain't real. The participation boy ain't real on the high side. You have to be competitive. You have to say in your realm, wherever you are, whatever your space is, this is my space right here. I'm coming to get every, you have to be competitive. Whether you like it or not, whether you feel comfortable or not. And here's, please listen to me. You have to get out of your personality. You have to do it. You have to stop doing the things that you love, that make you feel comfortable, that you want to do. And you have to get into a space where you got that dog. And let me say this to a lot of parents, right? When you say what's wrong with your kids, what's wrong with a lot of our kids is not that they bad kids. What's wrong with a lot of our kids is that we've given them everything they want, and we didn't know that while we was giving it to them, we was taking that dog away. You're looking at your child like, what's wrong with him? You took the dog out of him. You took the dog out of her. Everything, they ain't got to fight for nothing. They don't got to work for nothing. They don't got to earn nothing. It don't make them bad kids. Ain't nothing wrong with them. They great kids. They just ain't got that dog. And as long as they're in their house, they gonna be all right. But when they go out there without that dog, you better not die too soon. You better not leave this earth too soon, because ain't nobody gonna treat them like you treat them. I'm cool with that, but what I'm not gonna take away from you is that dog. You're gonna have that dog. You're gonna learn how to compete. You're gonna have to get up and go get yours. I can give you the whole world if I wanted to. I know some of you don't feel comfortable being competitive. I know it don't resonate with you. It don't feel good. But once you start doing business in corporate America, capitalism is doggy dog. Capitalism is by any means necessary. It don't mean you need to be evil. Even the word says, from the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom of heaven suffers violence, and the violent take it by force. You got to be forceful in this world. Do me a favor. If you don't want to be forceful, that don't make you a bad person. Get out of business. It's not for the weak at heart. Watch this. It says it's a strong desire. What kind of desire? Come on, what kind of desire? Come on, what kind of desire? A strong desire to win or be the best at something. That's why you hear me dressed like this. You see me with the Jays hat. I tell kids, I'm from Detroit. I'm from Chicago. I came from this. You can do it. I'm number one in the world. I don't say I'm number one for me. I already know I'm number one. I'm telling them. I don't care where you come from. Okay, where you can be the best. I don't want you just in the game to be in the game. I don't want you just making money. I want you to be the best at what you do. So what your daddy wanted to know? So what your mama was a teenager? Child? It doesn't matter. You don't need this, or that. All you need to be successful in this world is that dog. You got to wake up every day and compete. You got to go after it. Watch this. Able to compete successfully with others. Write that down. Scale to 1 to 10, 10 being highest. 10 being the highest of, I got that dog. Be honest. Don't play. Be honest with, yeah, 6. And when I say that dog, I'm sorry. I don't mean that dog when something go wrong. I just mean you wake up with that dog. Bills don't have to be the brand. You know what I'm saying? Like, it ain't no reason. It ain't nothing happen. You just wake up. You just wake up. Rawr, let's go. I didn't always have it. I prayed it away. Ignorantly. God, can't we all die? No, sir. There's an enemy. It ain't just all kumbaya. Watch this. Compete success. Look. You can't always be the most talented in the room. That's obvious. I'm in the room. You can't always be like naturally gifted, naturally talented. But watch this. You can be the most competitive. That's different. Talent and competitive is two different things. That's different. Now, my wife is smart. So I tell my wife all the time, like, I feel you, right? I feel you. But I'm going to raise my kids this way. Like, they need everything you give them. Two things I say to my wife. See, one thing I make my kids do, even though they don't want to do it, you're going to have to be a people, because you can't make it in this world if you ain't got connections. Talk. When we walk in the room, you're going to shake everybody's head. You're going to be a people person. Why? Because I've noticed the people in this world that are successful are people who have connections and are connected to people. No man or woman is an island. And let me tell you something. If you want to make yourself attractive, be competitive. Compete. I don't care nothing about your contract. Compete. I don't care nothing about your coach. Compete. I don't care how your people feel. Compete. Why? Because people who are competitive are attractive. Everybody want MJ on their team. Even when he retired, they want him. The Wizards want him. He couldn't even hardly dunk like he could when we were with. They're like, we want Jordan. Why? Because he's going to fill up the stands. Everybody want to play with Kobe. Everybody love the All-Star game. Everybody love the U.S. Olympics. Why? Because you get to play with Kobe. You get to play with Magic. You get to. A lot of people don't want you on their team, not because you're a bad person. They don't not want you on your team because you suck. They don't want you on your team because you don't compete day in and day out. And when you playing the Lakers, you playing against LeBron, you need somebody that can compete. The reason why they love Bron, because when Bron dunk, he could go like this, but Bron like, ah. They want to play with Bron, why? Because they know when his game's set. That's why we used to trip on who's the best of the best. And I don't know, I won't get into the debate. I just know people wanted to play with Jordan because they knew with Jordan, Jordan is going to take it to the hole. He ain't going to shoot. Jordan's, he had that dog. Maybe he wasn't the most talented. Maybe he wasn't the greatest player that ever played. He was the greatest dog that ever played. I don't do stats and all that. He was the greatest dog that ever played. If he could take you out, he would take you out. He had that dog. I'm trying to tell you, we live in a world where people came here, it was absolutely nothing in America. There was no building, nothing. They came and they came to conquer. They didn't come to play games. They didn't come just to build churches. They built San Francisco. They built Miami. They all had one thing in common. They were all competitive. There are those of you who want to do business, but you're not competitive. You have to be competitive to do business, and it doesn't matter how you feel about it.
Okay, let me say it this way. They looked at the most successful men and women of the world, and they found that they had like 7-8 things in common. And one of the things they all had in common was a routine. They are obsessed with their routine. They don't have a gap of wasted time in their routine. You know, I realized the reason why I'm so successful and the reason why I don't get in trouble like I used to when I was younger is because when I was younger, man, my schedule had so many gaps in it. The devil had like, okay, he might pray at 6, but my man is watching TV. He playing video games by 8:30. It's not that I'm sweeter than nobody. The devil can't get to me because all my time is taken up. And by the time he get to me, I'm asleep. I'm too asleep to sin. I'm just being real. 8:30, he like, Eric, you should. I'm like, bro, I'm tired. Come back to me tomorrow. You know what I'm saying? Like, tip me tomorrow, bro. I'm about to go to sleep. I'm good. I'm just tired right now. He's like, but no, you want to? I'm like, I don't want to do that. I'm tired. But let's try tomorrow morning. Right? And I'm being real. I get up at 8 o'clock in the morning. I'm sure he there. Like, I'm 3 o'clock in the morning. I'm sure he there. Like, yo, E, go back to sleep. Listen to me. I promise y'all. I got up the other day like at 3 o'clock in the morning, and I woke up, and I was just walking around like a zombie. I was like, I'm so tired. I heard the devil say, go back to sleep. I was like, yeah, you're right. I should go back to sleep. You know what I'm saying? I ain't gonna lie. I was like, bro, you want to something. You know what I'm saying? He's like, why are you getting up this early? You already number one in the world. You already number one in the world, E. You already doing what you're supposed to be doing. Like, E, you've been grinding. Just go ahead, it's 3. And my body said, yo, E, what would you go back to sleep for? I said, I'm tired. My body said, you're not tired. I said, well, why would you say I'm not tired? He said, because you woke up without an alarm clock. You woke yourself up. So if you were tired, your body wouldn't let you get up. If you were tired, your body would make you sleep to 6. You got up, it's 3. No, what you don't want to do is the grind, but you're up. So do me a favor, Eric, you don't even have to do anything. You don't even have to work. You've been getting up at 3 so early in the morning, don't even worry about it. Just put your shoes on, and when you get on the treadmill, it's just going to do it for you because you've been doing it every day for 3 o'clock in the morning. For real. My body said, all you got to do is put your shoes on. That's the hardest thing you got to do. Just put your shoes on and I'll do the rest. I can't put your shoes on for you, but put your shoes on and then just go. And I just went, and I was walking for the 11 incline boy, and I was just walking for an hour, and I was just like, you know what? It's almost an hour. I don't feel like running. And my body was like, don't even worry about it. We'll get to that when we get to it. I did my hour, was about to get off. My body was like, you know we run now. I said, what? We run now. Let's go. You ain't tired? I said, I am tired. No, you're not. You just walked for an hour. You're not tired, Eric. Your brain is telling you some dumb stuff. If you were tired, you wouldn't have been able to walk for an hour. Okay, so let's do this. Just run for 2 minutes. I'm trying to help somebody right now go to a whole other level. The Bible says the reason why you go back to sleep is because you've always gone back to sleep. It's like a default. You go back to sleep because you always, all you got to do is stop going to sleep, and then you're going to stop going to sleep. All you got to do is stop fussing and cussing, and you're going to stop fussing and cussing. All you got to do is stop spending all the money you got and start saving it. Listen to me. I became number one in the world. I became a millionaire not because I made more money. I became a millionaire because they told me millionaires only live off of 30% of their income. I want to make it plain for you. I became a millionaire because I did what millionaires did. I stopped living off 100%. I paid my tithe, and then I was like, all right, E, you only got 20% left. Put the rest up. So the first thing I did, listen to me, the very first thing I did to become rich, somebody said, E, to be rich, put 6 months of your earning to the side. So I was like, all right, bet. That's what the rich told me to do. So I put 6 months to the side. How long did it take? I don't remember, but I put it to the side. Then somebody was like, yo, E, you need to put $100,000 to the side. I was like, all right, $100,000. DD, we're going to put $100,000 to the side. Then somebody was like, yo, you need to get your credit score up to 800. I was like, all right, then get my credit score up to 800. And then somebody said, E.T., if you want to be Tony Robbins, there's no way you'll be able to be like those dudes when you don't have the language they have. You need to go get your master's and a PhD from a white institution. I said, what? I went to Oakwood. I went to HBCU. He was like, yeah, but you didn't learn the language of Zig Ziglar at Oakwood. So Oakwood is a phenomenal place. Oh, y'all not hearing what I'm saying. I just said something, you missed it. Now you need to go to Michigan State University. CJ, where's my, you see my master's degree anywhere? What about my PhD? Not in the office? Not at church? You ain't seen it in my house? I didn't go to Michigan State to get a PhD. I went to Michigan State to learn the majority language. You can't speak in corporate when you say ambulance. It doesn't make my community inferior, but I can't. So I went to every single class, and when the teachers was talking, they thought I was just doing homework. I wasn't. I was listening to how they conjugate verbs. I was listening to how they tell stories. I was like, I peeped it out, y'all. They way more linear. You ever been to a black church before? The pastor, he all over the place. My man told 6 stories. He didn't close none of them. My man had told 6 stories. I promise you. I don't know what you know what I'm saying? But in the hood, you just got to, you know what, you like, you finish it for him. He was like, this is what he was going to say. But he never said it, though. My man started 6 stories. He ain't finished none story. So that I realized when you do corporate, it's A, B, C, D, E, F. It's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. It's topic, body, body, body. It's topic, support, 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 conclusion. I didn't go to school. I'm not no kid. I don't need nobody 4.0. I don't need to be affirmed. I don't need your paper on my wall. I need your language, though, if I'm going to compete. I need your rules if I'm going to compete. I need your codes if I'm going to compete. The problem with most of you is you don't have a 1% language. You got a poverty language. No, I want to help you real quick. You think Warren Buffett reading just to be reading? The majority of you are poor because you read poor stuff. You watch poor stuff. You on Instagram watching fights. For real, you just scrolling through like you ain't got a life. For real, some of y'all on Instagram, you on there for 30 minutes. If I ask you what you saw, you don't even know. You just scrolling through. That's a poverty mindset. Rich people don't waste time. They realize it's their most important commodity. They don't watch a lot of TV. They don't do a lot of entertainment. If they're not working, they're studying their craft and getting better at their craft. Oh, you, okay, I'm sorry. Okay, let me say it one more time. There was a language that I needed to learn. Does it mean I need to abandon the language that I learned? Absolutely not. Does it mean I need to put on a shirt and tie? Listen to me. When I do corporate, I promise you, I look like this. I probably don't look this good. Sometimes I got on shorts and a t-shirt. In corporate, why? Because I don't need to necessarily conform. They're not asking me to come to dress up. But I'm so good at what I do, they don't even require a suit. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Some of us don't want to wear a suit, but you're not on that level, though. Or you want to wear a suit and act as if your suit is going to compensate for what you are inferior at. Your suit don't make your language sweet. For real, some of you wear suits because you think like you're going to impress somebody with a suit. And you might get in the door, but sooner or later they're going to find out who you are. So I need you to stop having the poverty mindset. So when I quit my job to be an entrepreneur, my mom was like, whoa, what are you doing? I was like, I'm quitting. My mom was like, don't you dare quit. You're going to embarrass me. You got a wife and kids. Does YouTube have insurance? Does YouTube have a 401k? And I was like, yo, mom, I ain't trying to be funny and I ain't trying to be disrespectful. I love you. But you can't teach me how to be a millionaire because you're not one. You come from the working class, and I'm not mad at you, ma. We wouldn't be where we are without you. But you told me that every generation is supposed to get better. So I'll take your values, but I won't take your work ethic. Because rich people don't work, they think. The working class will never get rich. It wasn't designed. Oh, okay. Listen to me, this country became a wealthy country because they had employees they didn't have to pay. That's not like a rocket science. So when this country had to start paying people, they want to pay the least. The 3% that run the world, they're not trying. Let me tell you how I know. I'm from Detroit. We just laid off 15,000 workers, and the president of GM, she just got $22 million. We got $22 million to give one person when we laid off 15,000 people, and we took their health care that's already paid for. No disrespect to nobody, and I ain't playing no victim because I'm not a victim. Rich people don't work, they think. Poor people work. Poor people go, clock in, I make this much an hour. Rich people go, I put them to work, and I make this much an hour. See, what happens is you're working for you and your family, one, they got 40 of you working at one time. So they're giving you 20%, and then they're keeping the 80% off of 15,000 people. That's enough to have $22 million. So what you have to decide is, are you going to keep being the 99%, or are you ready to be a part of the 1%? Because it doesn't make a difference where you come from, high school dropout. It doesn't make a difference where you come from, GED. It doesn't make a difference where you come from, sleeping in abandoned buildings. It doesn't make a difference where you come from, a 17-year-old mom that got pregnant. It doesn't make a difference where you come from, south side of Chicago. It doesn't make a difference where you come from, pretty much raised in Detroit. It doesn't make a difference where you come from, took 12 years to get a four-year degree. It doesn't make a difference. Well, you know what makes a difference? What makes a difference is when you become a 99% or a 1%. And when I start thinking like, acting like, and behaving like a 1%er, everything changed. Is that clear?
He told the guy, he said, when you want to succeed as bad as you want to breathe, then you'll be successful.
Listen to me very carefully. The Packers last week, they won the first quarter. What kind of game was it? When we got to the end, what type of game was it? It was a close game, right? It was a close game. Cowboys had a chance to win that thing. It was a close game. This game wasn't what? It was a blowout. It was a blowout. Why? Because not only did the Falcons win the first quarter, not only did they win the second quarter, they were up 24-0 at the half. They dominated. Now, I want to help some of you because some of you in this room, I don't want you just to compete because competing is dangerous. Because when you compete, you got to go all the way to the fourth quarter to make that thing happen. But when you dominate, pretty much, when they came back after the half, it was pretty much what? It was over. And the thing that's cool about dominating is when you dominate, you take your opponent out the game. if you line it up as a wide receiver, you kind of just like out there. You're not like, oh, let's go. You kind of like, oh, well, we lost. Let's just see how many points we can put on the board so we just don't get shut out. I am charging you not to be a student, not to be an entrepreneur, not to be whatever you are. I am charging you that in your space, you need to dominate in your space. So when Green Bay, who just won last week, come back after the half, they hold their heart gone. Green Bay came back and was like, Rodgers can't even save us. We can't be saved. All the Green Bay Packer fans was at home. I'm talking about miserable. If you like Green Bay, you like, it's over. You was pacing around the house. Atlanta was off the charts. Everybody in Atlanta was like, rise up. I'm getting texts from folks. I didn't even know they from Atlanta. Rise up. I thought you was from Detroit. I lived in Atlanta for 6 months. Rise up. Right? So I'm being real. Last week we talked about, you want to finish the first quarter. You want to. But now we want to talk about domination, right? And I'm going to show you in a second what that looks like. All right. So real quick, anybody know who this is? Serena. Good. Next one. This is, all right, good, we there? All right, next one. Okay, it's all right. All right, let's go right quick. Yep. And she beat Serena. Yep, let's go to the next one. Who's that? Okay, let's stop. So real quick, now what I gotta explain to y'all is this, they are all pros. Like, these are people who have beat Serena and Venus. They're all ranked. You don't know who they are, though. They probably won one or something. They might won one Grand Slam or two. So they're professional. They are pros. They're getting paid. In the tennis world, when they walk out, people like, sign my ball. People like, oh, but you don't know them. Why is it that you don't know them? Like, how you know Venus? You don't know Venus because she played tennis. You know Venus because there was a time in her career she dominated, and then her sister came, and she dominated. That's why you know who they are. Let me say this to you. This is what domination looks like. Venus has dominated in tennis, and as a result, she's made $34 million just in tennis. Serena has made $84 million just in tennis. That's what domination looks like. Now, when you go to these young ladies, it's like $8 million. That's a good salary. But they don't make what Serena and Venus make. Why? They have not dominated. So who is this? Yup, LeBron James. Yup. Next one. Yup, Steph Curry. Yup. Next one. Yup. Somebody know. But most of y'all are like, who's my man? My man play for the Nuggets. He started. He an NBA pro. Let's go to the next one. I know you know who this is right here. Boom! He with the Utah Jazz. He's not in the developmental league. He's not playing overseas. He's starting with Utah. You don't know him though. Why? Because he's not dominating. So we're gonna try not to compete. We're gonna try to do what? Come on, we're gonna try not to compete. We're gonna try to do what? I need you to dominate.
Single dude that I knew that was about it in business, they were disciplined. Right? Discipline. Now this one right here is spooky because I met a lot of men who were very successful financially and they thought because they had money they didn't have to be disciplined and they end up losing everything. They end up losing everything. They weren't disciplined. Right? They became alcoholics, right? Sex addicts, right? Didn't move with integrity. That's the one thing, man, I love about, man, y'all, man, for real, I'm telling y'all got to get with the right crew. Y'all, when y'all hear Maul talk about getting up and working out, it don't got nothing, man, I promise y'all, it don't have nothing to do with, like, I ain't following no man because he got muscles. I'm following Maul because he got muscles that come from discipline. Like, I promise you, you call Maul, like, yo, Maul, the podcast, you heard the podcast, yo, Maul, we want you to go see this, they try to, you know what I'm saying? Get Maul to see his billboard that's out there. Trying to trick Maul. Maul like, I can't do it. They like, we need you to come right now. He like, this is my workout time. Whatever you trying to show me, work out. I got to work out. I'm trying to get on this scale and be the same weight I was when I was coming out of college. That's discipline. I was like, you on a scale win? He's like, every day. I was like, that's my problem. How you been on the scale? How you been on the scale? About 5 years. I'm just guessing. I'm 189. You know what I'm saying? See, I feel 189. You know what I'm saying? The way my pants fit. 189. All right, let's go. Here's where me and my wife get into it. So my wife was like, first she said, you know, you need more structure. I was like, in my company, I was like, I don't need no more structure. Structure ain't the problem. I'm going to show you a whole bunch of structure. I said, I got it, sweetheart. I'm not willing to make the adjustment, but I don't run the type of company where I want to get up every day and what's the word I'm looking for? See, like, I don't want to get up every day and be nobody's boss. Does that make sense? Like, I don't want to get up and micromanage nobody, right? So the challenge is, at some point, you're going to have to learn to be disciplined. You're going to have to learn, if you say you're going to wake up at 8 o'clock, you're going to get up at 8 o'clock, no matter how you feel. Like, you got to be disciplined. And to get to the next level of success, you can't just have energy when you got energy. I want to make sure y'all catch that. If you're running a business and it's 365, then 365, you got to wake up every day and you got to go get it. You got, why? Because if you don't hunt, you don't eat. So here's the deal. If you hunted in January and you got enough food for January, you don't get to chill February. You got to get up in February and go get enough food. And so what a lot of us do, we aren't disciplined. Like, we're not self-motivated. We're not self-regulated. We need outside people to push us. And that's not how the Creator made us. He didn't make us for all other people to be over us. So here's what I told my wife. Sweetheart, if another human can tell you to get up and go to work and do what you're supposed to do, why can't you pretend like, if you need another human, be the human. You be that human. If you need somebody to tell you you need to lose 100 pounds, be your own voice to tell yourself you need to. Don't go pay nobody $50,000 to lose weight when you can do it yourself. And I'm not saying don't get a person, but at some point you got to cut that person off. Why? Because if you don't have personal discipline, you'll never get to the next level. The next level is not something that's far away. Like Maul said, the next level is execution is not something that, you know, we do, is something that we are. And most of us aren't disciplined. It's like you just go, like, you drink, so you just go, you can't tell yourself, you know what, I'm not mad that you drink, but you gotta drink during the weekday. Like, you drinking in the morning before you go to work? He gone now, he's no longer with us. You're drinking in the afternoon, you're drinking at night. Like, I'm feeling you like to drink, but like all day, every day, the weekend, the weekday. And some of you, there are things you like, you have absolutely no control. You are like a slave to you. You are a slave to your personality. You are a slave to some of your vices. You are a slave to some of the things you like. You are a slave. You have absolutely no control. And what I'm telling you is, the reason why we fast from time to time is not that we have to fast, but at some point, you gotta fast because you gotta tell the flesh who's in control. I'm in control. You're not in control. I know you don't want to wake up. You don't have an option. Get up. We trying to eat. There's a certain lifestyle we want. You think I want to get up at 3 o'clock? I put up a video. Nikki, I don't know what happened. I miscommunicated with Nikki this morning. I'm supposed to do the videos at 3, or either I give them to Nikki and then she'll do them. But some kind of way, I don't know. I must have went to sleep, woke up. I didn't know what time it was. So I sent Nikki what I wanted to say. And I looked this morning, I sent it at 12 o'clock at night, midnight. I thought I sent it like 10:30, 11. So when I got up, it was like 3-something our time. And I was like, shoot, I ain't put my video up. And I put the video up and I heard something in the back of my mind say, oh, it's okay, you're on vacation. I said, what? Oh, it's okay, they'll understand. I said, little man who getting up at 3 to read my stuff because he got somewhere to go, he don't know that I'm on vacation. He don't know that I'm here. That don't got nothing to do with his life. He don't know I'm in Mexico. I ain't posting no video. He don't have the slightest idea. He just know wherever he live in the world, at my 3 o'clock, he uses that stuff to do what he's supposed to do, and he's sitting there waiting. And an hour go by, he like, I guess he ain't posting today. Listen to me, I was so late posting, I almost didn't want to post because I was embarrassed. I'm like, I'm about an hour and 50 minutes, 2 minutes off. I'm 2 hours off. God said, post it anyway. That's discipline. Well, I don't got to post no videos. I'm way past posting videos. Posting videos was something we did to blow up. We blew up. I don't got to post videos. I don't post videos to get motivated. I don't post videos to get inspired. I post videos to be disciplined. Get your butt up and post the video. Either you post it the night before to Nikki, and she does it, or when you get up at 3 o'clock and you do it. That's discipline. That's a certain time frame that I'm supposed to eat, and certain things I'm supposed to eat and then not eat after a certain time. I'm making money. I can eat whatever I want, but I'm trying to discipline myself, because there was a time I did not discipline myself. You are not where you want to be, not because you need any more gifts. You don't need nothing else. You need to discipline yourself. You need to learn to tell you no. You keep talking about everybody else, you can't tell no. You can't tell you no. You can't tell you stop. You can't tell you quit. You can't tell you nothing. You got to get to a point where you're disciplined. And what separates the talented, if everybody's talented, if everybody's equally gifted, what separates us is discipline.
All of us will be successful in life if we don't quit. I promise you, other people are living. I was in Brisbane on Monday, and I went into the store about 10 o'clock in the morning on Monday, and the store was packed. I'm like, wow, it's folks shopping. I thought I got there early. 10:30, everybody shopping. And somebody thinking, I can't do this. Somebody else is doing it. Somebody else is doing it. There are people going and buying cars, cash, so they don't have a note. They don't have that thing over them. And you looking like, how in the world can I do that? I don't know, but they doing it. There are people who are traveling and leaving and going away for 3 months. And you like, I can't take a vacation. They taking it. Why can't you human like they are? Listen to me. All men are created equal. Some work harder. Some get up at 2:30 in the morning. Some are willing to get on a plane from New Zealand and come Brisbane, speak at a school, speak that night, get up in the morning, 5 o'clock, get to the airport. Come on, go to Sydney, get up, Melbourne, get up, go to Perth, come on. Then get back up and then go home. Are you here? All of us are created equal. Some of us just grind. Some of us don't make excuses. Some of us don't surrender. Some of us don't give up and give in. What we do with the pressure is we say, I gotta take it, and I gotta take it to another level. I'm telling you, you can live. And I'm not telling you something that I read in a book while I had two parents. Something I read in a book when my parents were upper middle class. Something I read in a book. My mama was 17 years old when she got pregnant. I had no advantages. But I woke up one day and realized all men are created equal. I don't need none. I'm my advantage. You your advantage. Why are you waiting for somebody to call you? Why are you waiting for somebody to liberate you? Why are you waiting for somebody to affirm you? Why are you waiting for somebody to tell you got a dream or go? Why are you waiting for somebody to take you by your hand and give you what's rightfully yours? However much money you make, whatever kind of life you have, that's yours. So when you hear my message, the reason why you resonate with my message is not because of the words I say. There are a lot of people on YouTube and TV talking the talk, but there's a sound that you hear that resonates with you because I'm speaking from that pain. I'm speaking from every aunt that I had to bury, for every cousin that I had to hear. He got 50 years and I try to act like it didn't hurt when he only 19 years old. He lost his entire life at 19 over some stupid stuff. Every aunt I buried, when I took my mother-in-law into that hospital room and I prayed for her before surgery, not knowing if she was coming out or not, not knowing if she was gonna die or not. And that's my wife's own, listen to me, she didn't grow up with her father. She doesn't have any brothers or sisters. Like, her mom is her life. It was just her and her mom. And my mind's like, yo, if my wife lose her mom, that's her life. Like, that's gonna affect us. Like, my wife ain't gonna be the same if her mom dies. You talking about getting cut. And so when I speak to you, I speak from the pain of taking 12 years to get a four-year degree. I speak to you as a failure who had to get back up every single doggone time and say, brush it off and keep going. And so it is not the message alone. It's not the words alone that resonate with you. It's that I am you. I've been through what you've been through, and I got up and I kept going. So listen to me very closely. You're going to get cut. All that stuff you wrote down, you're going to go through some pressure. So if you ain't ready for that, close that up and say, I just don't want to have no dreams. I don't want no dreams, no goals, no life. I don't want nothing in life. You're going to have a great marriage. You're going to go through some pressure. You're going to go through some heat. And then you're going to get cut. I'm just trying to give you the three-part process, because what's going to happen is you're going to see the heat. And you're going to be like, well, I went through the pressure. I thought that was it. That was phase one. That's phase one. Phase two coming. And then phase three, and watch what happens. All of us will be successful in life if we don't quit.